Solid revolutions is going to be the topic for this Manim tutorial. As you can see with these animations, they are going to be fairly complex. They're going to be in 3D scene. So let's go through the code for the first one, which is a little more straightforward than the second one and some of the other ones that you would be seeing on the screen. So the first one, we are creating a prism. This is a built-in function within a 3D scene where I've got a length, width, and height. Those are the dimensions I put into my prism. So you can make this to be a cube, you can make this to be any shape of rectangular prism that you wish. Then I want to illustrate the net of this, so I'm going to use some keyword arguments within each of my rectangles of my net. So rather than writing out the customizations or copying and pasting them every single time, I just add this keyword arguments onto the end of each. And now you can see with my net, I have got it as a vector group of all of those rectangles there where I've just got length and width for each of them. So this got a little bit confusing, and when I rendered it out in low quality, I actually had it orientated the wrong way. So all I did was rotate it, which is a little bit of shame, but I don't really care. Give an arrow between the prism and the net to give the effect that, yes, we are just unfolding this. Begin the rotation, set the camera orientation, play some stuff out, and then wait. Now this line of code here is thanks to the people in the Discord, okay? Because I asked them, how do you fade out everything in a scene without having to, you know, manually type some stuff out? And they just said, yeah, use that line of code. So any object that you create and add it to the screen, it'll fade it out at once. So that's, you know, a nice little shortcut. Then I stop the camera rotation. Now, if you're moving on from what you do in year 8 to, you know, when you calculate surface areas and you want to move on to what you do in university, which is calculating surface areas of solid revolutions, you might propose this question here. And with a little bit of Manim help, you can actually visualize this pretty nicely. So we begin the ambient rotation, and anything that I'm going to play until I stop it is going to be animated while spinning. So this will add to the rendering time, but that's no problem. Gives a nice effect. I add an axis, I add a function by calling it on the axis, and I add an area under that function on the same axis. I've got a parametric surface, which we know is given by theta for u, r for v, and it's on the x, y, z axis. Chuck those customizations in, and you can add all of the stuff that you've got or animate it out as a lag start like I've got. And then if you want to give the effect where you're saying, no, this isn't actually the volume, this is the surface area, you might illustrate out, you know, rotating the vector group of the area and the function around the right axis. So that would be the right axis over there, which is your x axis. And you would rotate it about 2π radians, about the point center of your axis. So it's not going to do anything funny on the screen. So that's how I've got the code out for that first animation there. Moving on to something a little bit more complex. What you're going to need to do when you are going over complex scenes is you're going to have to create your own helper functions, because not everything is going to be built in and templated. It's a growing library. So if you look at any 3 blue, 1 brown code, you will see he's got thousands of lines of helper functions that he calls within his animation. So it's quite impressive, to be honest. But if we look at our first helper function, these are the conic approximations that go on a 3D axis. So those are those truncated cones. Now, you define it. So I want it to go on an axis to a graph, an X minimum, X maximum, and a DX value with some customizations. You put everything in a vector group, and when you're calling a lot of them, you're going to need to use a for loop. This for loop will include non-integer values. So you go np.arrange, so numpy.arrange rather than just range, because range only includes integer values. Where here, I've got a conditional. Now, I was trying to work this out on pen and paper, and I think this is how you do it, but I'm pretty sure it's mathematically incorrect. But it gave the effect that I was looking for. Well, I had a parameter k, and if k was 0, it kind of stuffed everything up. So I've just included this conditional saying, if k is equal to 0, then, or if the function is equal to 0, which means that k would be equal to 0, then the conic approximation is a vectorized point, so it doesn't break anything down. Otherwise, play exactly how I want it to, where k is this value there, and that helped me give the effect of the truncated cones on a parametric surface that I was looking for. And you can see, I've got built-in dx values, x values. So these are all called within my definition up there. And then you return the result, and this will go through as a for loop, so it'll do it for every single value. So if you start from x minimum to be 0 and x maximum to be 2, like so. And it'll do it for all of those values you chuck in there. My second helper function, I called them Riemann truncated cones because they're called on a 2D axis. They're not actually Riemann rectangles. They're sort of like a mathematically incorrect way of showing the net of the truncated cone from my parametric surface, but it gave the effect that I was looking for. So again, you can see I've got a whole bunch of stuff there, and this theta will explain in a moment. So I've got a vector group, and then again, I create a for loop because I want many and many of these to occur. So the points are going to be a vector group, where normally your Riemann rectangle will have your 4 points there. In my case, I wanted them to be sort of like a truncated net. Ooh, not the look I'm going for. Like a truncated net, like so, where there's gonna be some bow in here. Okay, now the way that I've given this effect is by a arc polygon. And again, how I've gotten this all to configure out nicely is really thanks to the people in the Discord. Okay, otherwise I would have really been struggling with this aspect of it here. You give your customizations, and the nice thing about creating this as a function and as a for loop is that you can add value trackers to any of these when you're calling them in your code. So that's why you want to create these nice helper functions, so you can just call on them and add any value trackers or updaters that you want. Go through, because it's a for loop, it'll create a whole lot of them, and you return them and you add them to your result, which is what you want. So getting into the code of it, I create a 3D axis and I add some coordinates on there. I've got a graph and I've got a parametric surface. Now this parametric surface isn't actually updating, so I didn't need to redraw it, but it didn't really affect much at all. So it's just a parametric surface, and the reason why I don't actually need this always redraw is that there's no value trackers or anything in here. Okay, so I actually didn't need that statement there, but it's not like it screws anything up. A lot of the power of my animation here comes from this value tracker, so dx starting at 1. Now here I'm calling on my, so always redraw, I'm calling on my get conic approximation. So those are those 3D conics on the parametric surface, where I'm always redrawing because I want it to always be updated by the value tracker. So you can see there's a lot of consistency with how these animations play out. It's just the more complex ones are going to require you to create your own helper functions. I want there to be a dx value, and I want to illustrate that on the screen. So I need to add a mobject, decimal number mobject, where it's going to be the value of the value tracker. I then create a second axis. This is going to be my 2D axis. Put it to the edge. Now I've just created a surface area function. Really, I've gotten this from Wolfram, where I wanted a function on a 2D axis to be representative of, you know, all of the nets of the truncated cones onto a 2D axis. So this is how I've given that effect. I create the graph, which I'm calling onto axis number 2. I add the label, and I've got a value tracker of my theta within the truncated rectangles that go on the 2D screen. So this value tracker tracks the bonus of my truncated, of the nets of my truncated cones. Again, this is always redraw, because I've got a dx value and a theta value, which I am calling on, so I always wanted to update. Now this really, it's probably not mathematically it's definitely not mathematically correct, but I don't really mind because it gave me the effect that I was going for. Probably not best practice, but I don't teach this stuff, so I'm not going to be explaining it to anybody. I'm just illustrating it for your own good of learning how to use Manim. I set the camera orientation, I add the stuff to the screen, I move the camera, so I give that effect that it is going to be moved. Now this phi 0 theta at negative 90 means I'm on flat XY, and then I move the camera so it looks now like it's moved to a 3D scene. I add the stuff with a lag start, and then I make a transform the conic approximations from the 3D, and I make a copy of them, and I put them under the curve on the 2D graph. So it kind of gives that effect that, hey, these truncated cones on the parametric surface are representative of the area under this particular curve. And then I play out my value tracker. And so then this is how you give that nice effect of maybe if you were trying to explain the surface area of solid revolutions.